our hands together. Hallelujah. And receive our pastor, Dr. Byron G. Brazier, and the sanctuary choir. Come on, everybody. You're all I need. You're all I need.
You're all I need.
Every breath you breathe through me.
You're all I need.
Let your rivers flow through me.
You're all I need.
Every breath you breathe through me. You're all I need. Let your rivers flow through me.
You're all.
Tell somebody next to you, tell them, I need him, I need him. Hallelujah, I need him. Bless the name of Jesus. Let's receive our pastor, Dr. Byron T. Brady.
If you need the Lord, somebody should shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
If you need the Lord, someone should shout, thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
This is the day. This is the day that the Lord has made. And we shall rejoice and be glad in it. I thank the Lord for being in the house one more time. It's a marvelous thing to wake up every Sunday knowing that you've made it through on Monday and on Tuesday and on Wednesday. That the Lord bless you on Saturday and he woke you up this morning. He started you on your way. And so as we prepare to go before the Lord in prayer, we thank the Lord for our bishop who's in the house with us. We always pray for the hand of mercy being upon our bishop. But we also thank the Lord for souls who have come in to worship with us today. And we pray for a wonderful service, that as the word goes forward and as the choir sings songs unto the Lord, that hearts will be stirred and touched, and that there will be someone who will come and give their life to the Lord. But I pray for the saints each and every day, that the saints are strengthened by the word of God. But as we also pray, let us make sure we pray for that soul that's standing next to us. And it does not matter how well you think you know that soul. We need to pray for that person, the one behind you, the one who sits over here, but you know somebody over there. We can never be tired, and we should never tire of praying for one another. Amen?
Amen.
Let's give God a hand praise. At this time, let us go before the Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we come giving honor, glory, and thanks for your goodness and your mercy. We thank you for this special time that we come to worship you together in spirit and in truth. We come for one reason and one reason only, and that is to worship you and to thank you for all that you have done. And so as we go forward in this service, we pray that we'll lift up our voices. We'll sing praise unto your name. We will have a joy in our souls that allows us just to shout hallelujah, and hallelujah anytime we get ready. We pray, oh Lord, that you will be with our choir, that you'll be with the word as it goes forward. But we also ask that you will bless hearts and souls today. Bless this congregation. Bless our bishop. We ask, O Lord, that you'll extend your hand of mercy upon the Gaddis family, O Lord, who is in bereavement right now. Lord, we ask that you will strengthen each and every one of us. Keep us in a mighty way, and we will forever give you the honor and the glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
This afternoon's scripture is coming from Ephesians chapter 4, verses 1 through 5. Let us read together. I, therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you that you walk worthy of the vocation wherewith you are called, with all lowliness and meekness, with long suffering, forbearing one another in love, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, even as you are called in one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism. And this is the word of the Lord.
both my hands and I begin to worship Him. I worship Him.
Oh, God, I extol you and adore you, dear Jesus. Oh, Jesus, you have my praise. You have my praise, dear Jesus, Son of the living God. I extol you and adore you, dear Jesus. Oh, Jesus, I'll tell the world that you have my praise. You have my praise, dear Jesus, Son of the living God. I extol you and I adore you, dear Jesus, dear Jesus. Oh, Jesus, you have my praise. Lord, you have my praise. Dear Jesus, Son of the living God, I extol you and oh, Jesus, you have my praise. Nobody but you have my praise. Oh, holy, holy Lamb of God, when I behold him, I must bow before him. Great Messiah, I've come to lift him higher. Have my praise, Lord, you know you've got my praise. Oh, our God is holy. Oh, yes, he is. When I behold him, I bow before him. Great Messiah, help me lift you up a little higher. Hold him, we bow before him. Great Messiah, a little higher. Oh Lord, you have my praise. Oh,
I had to come. just wanna say thank you for how you healed my body, Lord. See, I never thought that I was gonna die, 'cause I remember that he was wounded for my transgressions, and he was bruised for my iniquities. By his stripes I'm healed and I'm set free. And just like he restored the woman with the issue of blood,
come back just to say thank you. Amen, amen, amen. I thank the Lord just to be able to say thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Oh, glory. Thank you. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I feel like shouting this morning. Just to come back. Say thank you. Oh, is the day that the Lord has made. Just came back, made me come back to say thank you. The choir has certainly brought us to a place to hear the word of the Lord. It's always good to say thank you. And it just so happens that one of the passages of scripture that I'm going to use today deals with that one who came back to say thank you. It was not planned that way, but the Lord made it that way. There are two passages of scripture that I'd like for you to turn to. The first is Luke chapter 17, beginning with verse 12, which is the passage of scripture that the choir just sang. And then if you put your marker in that passage, I'd like for you to turn to St. John chapter 9, beginning with verse 32, which is the account of the blind man born blind. So we have two accounts, one of the leper and the other of the blind man, that gives us reason to say thank you. Gives us reason to lift up our voices, our souls. Gives us reason for someone to come down the aisle and give their life to the Lord. It gives us reason that when we wake up in the morning, we're going to walk a better life than we walked on Saturday. And on Tuesday, it's going to be better than on Monday. And on Wednesday, it's going to be better than on Tuesday. Because the Lord has just been that good. There's nothing more profound then when the Lord calls you out of darkness and makes you whole. Many feel that they're whole just like they are. But when the Lord does something special in your life, when you think of the goodness of Jesus and all that he has done, when you know that you could not have made it through unless the Lord intervened, and you didn't even ask him, but he wanted to show you he could, because he's been dealing with you all along. You just been kind of stubborn and rebellious. I don't want to do this. But today is the day that when you were getting ready to leave and go your merry way, the Lord put something in your heart and said, I need to go back to say thank you. We have all been through, we all have had testimonies. We just need to remember. When the Lord is dealing with you, the first thing Satan does not want you to do is to remember. He wants you to forget about that car accident the Lord pulled you out of. He pulled you out of it without a scratch. He wants you to remember when you got carjacked and the Lord brought you out. He wants you to remember when they were chasing you down the street and you don't know how you got away, but they gave up and you got away. You got to remember where the Lord brought you from. How you were deep, deep, deep in darkness, and how the Lord went deep, deep, deep and brought you to the light, light, light. The last thing he wanted you to do is remember. But that's the first thing we should do. Remember what the Lord has done. And because we remember, we praise him. And when I talk about praise, I'm not just talking about a thank you of hospitality. No, no, I'm talking about a deep gut praise. Where you say, Lord, I'm going to praise you today. A praise for your wholeness. A praise because he brought you through. A praise because far too many have been hung out to dry. But the Lord has seen fit to cover you with his grace, his mercy, and his blood. So as we take a look at these two passages of scripture, Luke chapter 17, beginning with verse 12, it says, "And as he entered into a certain village, there met him 10 men that were lepers, which stood afar off. And they lifted up their voices and said, Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. And when he saw them, he said unto them, Go show yourself unto the priest. And it came to pass that as they went, they were cleansed. And one of them, when he saw that he was healed, when he understood, Lord, you just healed me. I asked you. I don't know you. You don't know me. But the Lord did know him. But he didn't know the Lord. When he saw that he was healed, turned back and went with a loud voice, glorified God. And with a loud voice, glorified God. And fell down on his face at his feet, giving him thanks. And he was a Samaritan. And Jesus answering said, Were there not 10 cleansed? But where are the 9? There are not found that return to give glory to God save this stranger. And he said unto him, Arise, go thy way. Thy faith has made thee whole. Now I want you to turn to John chapter 9. We're talking about the grace and mercy of God. Because my subject today is the heart of gratitude. You know, sometimes you just need to be grateful. Remember what the Lord has done. In John 9:32, the blind man who was healed is now talking to the Pharisees. And in verse 32, he says, Since the world began, was it not heard that any man opened up the eyes of one that was born blind? If this man were not of God, he could do nothing. They answered and said unto him, they answered to the blind man, Thou wast altogether born in sins, and dost thou teach us? And they cast him out. Jesus heard that they had cast him out, and when he found him, now they cast him out. The Lord heard they cast him out. And then the Lord went and found him. He found him. The man didn't try to run around to find Jesus. Jesus came and found him. And he said unto him, Dost thou believe on the Son of God? He answered and said, Who is he, Lord, that I might believe on him? And Jesus said unto him, Thou hast both seen him. Now, he didn't see him before. He sees him now. Thou have both seen him, and it is he that talketh with thee. And he said, Lord, I believe. And he worshiped him. Can the church say amen?
Amen.
These are two marvelous passages of scripture. One who came back to say, Lord, I thank you. And the other, the Lord came and found and brought and said, Dost thou believe? And I trust that as I provide this sermon that the Lord has given to me, that someone's heart will be strengthened and touched. And you will come and give your life to the Lord. But also to know that we always need to have a heart of gratitude and remember what the Lord has done in our lives. Life is not easy. Life can be like leprosy. Life can be like being blind. But I know this one thing, that once I was blind, but now I see. We have these two accounts, the story of the leper. And we know that leprosy was a horrible disease. It was one that separates you from your loved one, and you have no support system at all. You're just out there. You're put away. And we need to make sure that we as family, we don't put our elderly away. Amen. It doesn't mean that you don't make sure they have good care when you can't care for them yourself, because sometimes you can't care for them. I'm not talking about always making sure that they're in your home, because you may not be able to take care, even though you would love to. But we can never, ever forget our elderly. We can never forget our young, and we can never forget anybody in between. Amen? Amen. We remember each other. Now, Jesus healed all of them and did not require any assistance from anybody else. All he told them, he said, go your way and see the priest, which is what they had to do. But after that miracle, this one unbeliever, a stranger, something happened in his heart, and he said, I must go back. I must go back. Because the Lord already told him, he said, arise and go thy way. Told him, go thy way. Show yourself to the priest. But when this man came back, the Lord said, thy faith has made thee whole. But when you take a look at this blind man, this man had to battle with the Pharisees. He battled with the Pharisees because he was blind. They did not want him to be blind because they didn't want to give Jesus the credit that he had healed a blind man when no one else could have ever, they never heard of anybody being healed from blindness that was born that way. And you have to understand, when you are born blind, there are functions that do not even exist. They're atrophied in your eyes and in your nerves. They do not exist. But when the Lord said, go put mud on your eyes, it wasn't the mud that healed them. It was his faith. It was obedience and the word of the Lord. And he was healed and was able to see. And the enemies of Jesus did not want this man to be blind, but he was blind. And they even went to his parents and said, was your son born blind? And he said, yes, this is our son. And he was born blind, but how he sees, now you got to go ask him. He is of age. Born blind. And even when the Pharisees looked at him and said, give God the praise, for we know that this man is a sinner. Call Jesus a sinner. But then this blind man rose up. Something happens inside of when the Lord does something with you. Something happens on the inside. And you begin to rise up. And something rose up in this blind man, and he looked at them and said, whether he be a sinner or no, I know not, but one thing I do know is that whereas I was blind, now I see. There are going to be people you are going to face who are going to tell you that the Lord didn't do anything for you. that Jesus really wasn't the Christ, that Jesus wasn't this and he wasn't that. And you should be able to tell them that they're like the blind man. Something inside you should just raise up. And say, whether Jesus be all what you say he is or not, but one thing I do know, that once I was a drug addict and now I'm not. Once I was an alcoholic, but now I'm not. Once I was a philanderer, but now I am not. Once I was this, but now I am not. That's all I know. And I remember how I used to be, and I'm not that way anymore, and I did not do it by myself. Jesus came and found me where I was, brought me out. And today, we give thanks. We praise him. We praise him loud. We praise him louder than they do in White Sox Park. We praise him louder than they do the Blackhawks on Stanley Cup Parade. We praise him louder than we did when Michael Jordan was here. We praise him. We're going to praise the Lord. Because it was the Lord that found me. All the ball players, everybody else making $100 million, they didn't find me. They don't care nothing about me. I know who cares about me. Jesus. Now there are those who will ask you, well, what are you going to get from the Lord? What are you going to get? As if serving the Lord is a return on investment. Make a plan, Pastor. All right. What are you going to get? The world will ask that question. Some look at the coming of Jesus as you should be getting a blessing. And to do good works, you should be able to get something for that. It's not enough that the Lord found you and saved you. You want another return on investment. Look what I'm leaving. Look at all the sacrifices I'm going to leave behind because I'm now going to serve the Lord. You ain't leaving nothing you didn't want to leave a long time ago. These are questions of return of investment. And it assumes that you've got something worth investing in. It assumes that you have something of value if in fact you believe in return on investment, it assumes that you've got something that you want to give to the Lord that is worthy of the Lord sending you a blessing. Now, since we are all dead in trespasses and sins, you got to ask yourself, what is it that I have that is of value to the Lord that I'm going to get something back on when I give him this? What you have is not sufficient enough. It was God who sent his only begotten son to die for your sins. What do you have that's greater than his son who died and nailed your sins to his cross? What do you think you have? Our sacrifice. Peter said that to Jesus. He said, we've sacrificed fathers and mothers. And he said, you haven't sacrificed anything more than you haven't gotten 100-fold more for from me. When the Lord gives to you, he gives you 100-fold more than you're going to give back to him. And some more besides. You've got to know that the Lord is just going to be the grace that is required in your life to bring you through. It's not about return on investment. You need to thank him for what he's done, give him praise for what he's done. Because when you praise him, you say, Lord, I thank you. I'm healed. You made me whole. As I went and as I was going, I found myself just being blessed, having grace and mercy all over me. You covered me with your blood, and as I went, it got deeper, and as I went, it got stronger. And Lord, all I want to do is just go back. Not go back to the world. I want to come back to the altar. I want to come back. I want to go on my knees just to say one thing. Lord, I thank you. I just thank you. I used to be blind. But Lord, you've allowed me to see everything that I was missing in you. I thought I had something. But Lord, when I look at what you have provided for me, let everybody else talk about you. Let them say whatever they're going to say about you. But I'm going to say this, that I remember where I used to be, and I know where I am right now. I remember what the Lord has done. And you didn't love the Lord first. No, the Lord loved you first. The Lord came and found you. The scripture says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. Said God commended his love toward us, that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. It is Christ that was taken to the cross and nailed our sins to his cross. I remember the song so vivid in my mind when it said, the blood that Jesus shed for me way back on Calvary. The blood that gives me strength from day to day. And it shall never, 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 never lose its power. His blood. So no matter where I am, I walk in power. I walk in his grace. I walk in his mercy. Let trouble come if it will, but I know that the grace of God is always right there. You gotta know that you were the one who was chosen before the foundation of the world. You were the one that he filled with the Holy Spirit. You are the one who left his promises for you. You are the one that Jesus already died for and sent the Spirit back to abide with you forever. It was you. It was you. It was you that you feel. You who feel the Holy Spirit churning in your soul even as I speak right now. In fact, you don't even know why you're not jumping up shouting right now, because you feel his Spirit in your life. So it's not about investment. This is about grace. Said, because after the Lord appeared, after his kindness and the love of God and the Savior appeared toward us, the scripture said, not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy, he saved us. He saved us. He renewed us. He made us heirs according to his promise. So I'm thankful today. I don't know about you, but I'm thankful today. I am thankful that the Lord saw fit. I'm thankful for his love. I'm thankful that he cared for me. I'm thankful that he blessed me with a family. And he allowed me to take care of my family. When I didn't have anything, when I was broke, the Lord blessed me to take care of my family. I know what broke is. You probably say, well, Dr. Bay, you don't know what broke is. I know what broke is. I know what it feels like not having a job. I know what that feels like. I know what it feels like when you ran out of money. You say, you know, you look at me now, but what you see now, it wasn't that way 20 years ago. No, no, I was a different fella 20 years ago. But I thank the Lord that when I was broke, the Lord blessed me. I made it anyhow, not because of me, but because of him. The Lord has blessed each and every one of you. When you had nothing to give, the Lord gave you something in your life. He blessed you. We need to give him thanks today. Praise him today. Lift up his name today. There is nothing that we should think that the Lord left us in any way. We might be going through some trouble right now. You might be going through some trouble in the near future, in the distant future. But I'm here to tell you that no matter what I'm facing now, or what I'm facing later, or what you're facing today, or what you might be facing tomorrow, there's one thing that will always be on your lips, and that's a praise. Lord, I praise you. I'm not giving up my praise. I'm not gonna get disappointed. I got a praise. And can't nobody take your praise. Can't nobody separate you from the love of Christ, from the love of God through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Nobody, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature. I don't care if it's a four-legged creature or a two-legged creature. I don't care what the critter's name is. Nothing can separate you from the love of God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Let us give God a hand praise. As the baptismal committee comes, this is the time where you come back home. My sermon this morning was, it's time to come back home. There may be someone here who's heard the word of the Lord, and now it is your time to say, Lord, I'm going to come back like the man with the leper, and I'm going to give my life to you. Is there one? Come on down, young man.